With Gérard Michel, who is a professor at IAM Sorbonne from Paris. So the topic of my talk today is close to yours, Stefan. So it's about artificial intelligence. And what I will try to share with you is how we could use marketing science. So marketing science is a key pillar in my company and in my area, because I'm working for GfK, a market research company. So marketing science is everywhere in a company like GfK. So I will try to propose a framework to use marketing science as a pillar to go to artificial intelligence, thanks to Bayesian networks. So this is a proposal. So let's see how it could be. So the agenda for today's little slides about inspiration, why I am coming here today to visit the proposal. Then I will share a global process for this framework, and I will share two examples that perhaps could illustrate what we are thinking about. And then we'll go to the next steps. Okay. So inspiration. So, as usual, Stefan. Okay. So, because as you said, Stefan, I had the chance to attend a lot of our meetings since the creation of the Bayesian Lab conference. And also I have the chance to follow you on Facebook, with your emails, lots of communication. So you are a key people for me for the inspiration. So you, in your communication, you're talking a lot about artificial intelligence, and you said that Bayesian networks can bring artificial intelligence to problems for which we process little or no data. So as a market research company guy, I am very happy with this kind of remarks, because yes, we have a lot of data in market research company, but big data, yes, sometimes, but not in all the domains. So this kind of inspiration is very good for us. So thank you for that, Stefan. So after Stefan, perhaps you know this famous guy, Mr. Horvitz. So I was sure of that.
Are actually constellations of competencies, constellations of abilities, components, coordinated in a beautiful way so well that it feels like a unitary intelligence, single decision maker. The simultaneity of our hearing and our talking and our thinking, but in reality, I think there's a rich and deep symphony of many intelligences working together. And some of our research at Microsoft and with colleagues is about pulling together these pieces and figuring out what is the glue, what is the coordination, who's the conductor, and how does that work?
So be sure that I will not come today with this answer, but what is the glue? But I will propose something, okay? So something for the community, and we will be able to improve. But I think perhaps this is a way, but not the final solution, of course. So this is just in case the video will not work, but I think it's okay for everybody. So okay, but he's a very good thinker, Mr. Horvitz, so from Microsoft Research. So his daily activities is to think about AI. Okay, so for me, the mindset here is, yes, if we want a sort of a global artificial intelligence, we cannot build it just by itself. We have to combine to find some little piece of intelligence and try to work with them. And that's it. And let's do what the best we can do. So then, another famous guy in the domain is Stuart Russell. So he has a very good talk at the TED, at the last TED talk. And his topic was about robots, you know, this thing, etc. So for me, I have just extract some inspiration from him, because he's telling that human behaviors provides information about humans' values. So behaviors tells a little about your internal values. And values, so if you know values, if you know behaviors, perhaps you can know values, and perhaps you would be able to learn to how to predict which life you would prefer as a human being. But this is their thinking. And when you work in market research, so you have this kind of so very famous guy like Philip Kotler, who said, hey, for 100 years, marketers have collected data on what, how, and why consumers buy and what they buy. So this is for business purpose, not global behavior, but for economics behavior. So he says the data is there. Oh, okay, the data is there for 100 years. So let's have we could have a quick run on the internet. So it's very difficult to find all the data for 100 years, and it's easier to use marketing science and all the publication and the papers that the community has the kindness to share. So especially we have big review in market research, we have marketing science, we have jams, we have many reviews. Yes, we do not have the data for 100 years, we directly, but we have publications and we have papers, so perhaps we can have a look on it. So in this kind of literature, we find a lot the conceptual synthesis use structural equation modeling. Okay, so this is well known, and this is close to what we use in Bayesian networks. And so from this marketing science literature, we can catch some structural equation modeling. And the year when I did not have the chance to come to the conference, Lionel is also here for the inspiration, provided a very good talk about the causal analysis with structural equation models and Bayesian networks. Okay. So you see this long chain of inspirations coming from Stefan to Lionel, okay, for artificial intelligence. So for the general process, so what I have described, so in the market research, we always need to define a research question. So we always have to answer a question. So this is as usual. So the process that here we propose is very classical. Let's have a look to the bibliography, different articles that could answer and answer the question. Select those relevant articles, catch the good models in it, and try to replicate the models with Bayesian networks. Okay, so this is the heart of this talk: proposal to replicate good models, and then analyze as usual and predict as usual, and combine like Mr. Horvitz said, try to combine different artificial intelligence. So example number one. So it's an example about loyalty and brand personality. This is just by chance. I was working with Geraldine on another publication, and she sent me this article about loyalty and brand personality. And when we so with a, coming from a good journal, it was JAM, I think. So what is very interesting is that you can go very quickly, you can see what is the problematic in the abstract. So it looks to be a good article, and then, wow, you find this kind of good data visualizations, because this is data visualization, with a model, very simple here, and very useful perhaps for the show today. So here we can see that the model is a structural equation model, okay, very simplified with a little not so much information. We have different constructs. Here we have the brand personality, the competitive differentiation of the brand, so different concepts that we are used to work with in market research. And all these variables are linked to a good variable, which is a fit between the intention of the brand, personality, and the real realization. And then this fit is linked to brand loyalty. Brand loyalty is the very key concept in market research, because loyalty is with loyal customers, so you make money from it. And then you have market share. Okay. So this is a very simple model, not very complex. On the market, we can find much complex models, but this is the example. So here we have a good model, and if the objective is to transfer this model in the Bayesian network framework, okay, with Bayesian lab. Okay. So here this is very simple. You just have to draw the arrow, the different nodes, etc. But when you do not have the labels, you have this warning logo, saying that it's a very, you have to do something else. You have to specify the distributions and the TPC in each node. Okay. So how to do that? It's a big headache. And is it possible? So come back to Lionel's talk when I was not there. So Lionel, so I was very confident because I could read that Lionel provided some insights about this topic. So he said in his paper that the coefficients that correspond to what we can see here in the traditional structural equation modeling, they are Bayesian standard direct effects. So we have them in the center. So well, super. So this is the first step. So all the work now is to be able to specify the nature of the nodes, the link and the link between the nodes. So with the brand loyalty here. Okay. So I have followed exactly the same process as Lionel, which was a very first good trick. So I will try to spend a little of time here because it was not so easy yet. It's many hours of research here. So perhaps you will think it's very easy, but it was not so easy. Okay. So first you have to define the nature of the node. Okay. So in the article, yes, we have information about the latent variable, so coming from different manifest variables. So here we do the abstraction of that. So which kind of distribution will you choose to represent the fit between intended and realized brand personality? So here I have followed Lionel's what you did, Lionel, in your article. So I use just a very simple binary node with just a low and high level, and with a continuous type, and from 0 to 1. So here, this is the very simple way to define a node from 0 to 1, but it's a binary node, so it's okay. And the same for the brand loyalty. The hypothesis is that all the latent variables are equally distributed. Okay. When when everything is natural. So the objective so now is to define the TPC to be able to have the same coefficient, the standardized direct effect. And here we to represent the good link between the first variable and the second variable, here's the TPC that we have to put in is this one. So this is not magic. So here this is a very simple way because we only have two variables. So we can try and error with dichotomic approach, and it's just an estimation here with no formula, and you try to just with this simple network to replicate the standardized direct effect. And I was very happy because 0.59 and 0.59 in the initial model is very cool. And in the structural equation model area, we have also other representation, especially in PLS methods, where we have errors. Okay, so this could be another representation of the model, just to add error connected to the, and so then you have to specify another TPC. And for the adjustment of the TPC, then I could share with you after. So I have a proposal, but I am not so convinced it's the only way to do. And but I have a way to do that. So this is cool again. Because this is cool because when I have deployed this method for the most complex part of the model, so I was able to generate a TPC, more complex TPC, many lines, because we have five and six variables, so it's a big TPC. And I was able to respect the different order for the ranking, okay. But not able to achieve the same coefficients. So I may suspect this is a problem in the article. Because when you do the sum, it's not exactly very good, it's over one, and also you don't have a visualization of the correlation between the others. But I think it's a good approximation. For example, you can find some papers with different way to estimate, to do estimation of global model. You can use PLS, you can use AMOS with a traditional covariance matrix. And they come with very different solutions. You know, this solution is different from this one. But if you compare this solution with a PLS, it will be also different. So, but the ranking are almost the same. So this is we can take that as an approximation of what was the initial model. So this is the best that I was able to do. So once you have that, so it's as usual. So you have the nice data visualization. I think it will be better with virtual reality, but you can play as usual. So it was just an article, and then this is the magic of the Bayesian networks. You have no data, nothing, and you can analyze, you can play. So this is very, very interesting. So it was for the first example. Example number two. The resource question was, we often have this kind of question in the market research, what is the link between the satisfaction and loyalty? What is the difference between the different concepts? When I have to do some market reactions, is it better to act on satisfaction or loyalty? How does it work? So our American colleagues have did some very great work. They have proposed this kind of model. So it's a very famous model, which is an American Customer Satisfaction Index. And this model is, you have the satisfaction here and the loyalty and other dependencies with the customer complaints, the perceived value, the perceived quality, and the customer expectation. And you have all the links, all the causality between the different constructs. And this is a well-known model because some studies said that there is a link between the performance of the satisfaction index and the performance of the share of the brand in the market on the market. So it's linked to finance KPI, so this is always a problem. So the objective was to take this model and to put it in a Bayes network. So you could find very easily some coefficient, and with the same kind of method, it was possible to build the Bayes network that reflect this model. So now we have two models, and the idea here is to combine model one and model two. So this is a proposal. And so on the model one, we have the brand loyalty, which is directly linked to market share. And on the model two, we saw that we have the satisfaction, which is linked to the brand loyalty. So we have brand loyalty. So that we can try to do something and combine. So, and to combine them, so in Bayesian Lab, you have the smallest icon. So, to be honest, I've never used it, I've never seen it before. So thanks to Denis helped me to find it. And so, if you have it here. So it's possible in Bayesian Lab, as I have used the same framework to build this model and this model. You remind the nature of the nodes, it was binary nodes from the world, and then it was possible to do the connection. Okay. So I know this is an approximation, and because I am a researcher, perhaps we have correlation between those nodes and those worlds. So this is approximation. This is a proposal. Okay. And here you have the specification, so this is very easy. When you have a high loyalty here, then this node is sure that you have high loyalty here. So then you have the information that is coming from one model to another, and it's possible. So once you have that, so you can, as usual, analyze and predict. And here you can build the traditional tables to explain the market share. So it's like a confirmation of the paper I was referring to before, that thing that the satisfaction here is linked to the performance of the company. Because here we have satisfaction and then the link with the market share. So this is a way to combine models, but we could imagine something perhaps more technical, because now we are in algorithm world. So this model could be embedded in an API. So like you said just before, we can have some API queries from the two models and have another algorithm that combines the two models. So this is possible. This is another way. So that's it. So when I have presented this to Jeremy Michel, who is not very familiar with Bayesian networks, so she was very happy. So she's a very high-level professor in marketing, and for her, this is the ideal tool for decision-making. I think this is Bayesian networks in general. Okay. In many fields in marketing, according to the conceptual models inserted, but she has understood that it was possible to combine different models, and in especially for meta analysis, because they have to use this kind of things. She thinks this would be very useful. So for the next steps, I have several. So yes, define a more robust and I am confident with the methodology because I was able to. This is not I did several models. So I have the more complex than this one. So, but I will. Something it would be good that to publish a methodology to share more precisely with the community, etc. So, and to define the precise requirements and to how to do model structure alignment, because sometimes in the publication you have very, very complex models, so you have to choose for is it here, this is a correlation link, perhaps if you read a little, hey, perhaps it could be better to have a causality direct link. So to have better rules, it would be good, and certainly a reliable method for this standardized direct effect estimation. And so I have shared the simplification with a binary variable, binary nodes. So in the reality of the market research and perhaps of other metrics measurement. It's not always binary, it could be four modalities, five, etc. So we could have to, it would be good to work on the transportation of the distributions. As our next step, so perhaps leverage the marketing science knowledge in the traditional research phase, because once you, with this kind of methodology, perhaps we can have many models coming from fundamental research and perhaps also from private research from agencies. When we work for companies, we just implement one study. We have a model and after we do not use this model. So perhaps we could just accumulate. You know, some people accumulate data in their big data. Data warehouse, etc. But we could also accumulate models like that. It's very easy. And do some meta-analysis oriented. Another next step is to leverage this marketing science knowledge in the AI space. So, with massive use of API and text, as we said just before. I know it exists some theory about the combination of Bayesian networks, so it would be good to have a look, close look in this space. And also combine the Bayesian networks with other very popular techniques, like neural networks, convolutional neural networks, neural networks, etc. And yes, well, what could be also perhaps possible is to build everything is open now. Why not build a big open Bayesian network library? So, personally, I would be okay to share what I've done and share models. So to have a big community, perhaps in the Bayesian networks, but especially in the Bayesian in market research companies that use the Bayesian network. So, perhaps have a better collective intelligence in our domain. That's it. Thank you.